Howdy. Welcome back to Dion Talk. Today I'm with my friend Matt from Lumberjack Landlord, and he's done significantly more deals than I have. He has a larger portfolio. He uses the BRRRR method, so he's used hard money and refinanced. He's done cash out refinances on his properties. He's in the middle of doing one right now on a portfolio loan. So I really want to tap into his experience because I've got a system for doing this, but I want to hear, Matt, what you do when you're talking to lenders. What are the strategies that you use to get the best rates, the best terms, the best conditions? If you could just go through from start to finish what that looks like on conventional lending.
Happy to be here, Dion. So I don't call them up and say, your choice, give it to me or I hang up, because they'll let me hang up. So, so we don't do that. Make sure that you're shopping that, talking to multiple resources, that you're talking to a mortgage broker, that you're also talking to a credit union, and that you're also talking to a bank. I would look at all three aspects, talking to credit union, bank, and a mortgage broker. Mortgage brokers, for those of you who don't know, they have access to typically anywhere from 6 to 30 banks that they can work with. That means that they have all these different programs. Everybody's not cookie cutter. Everybody's not alike. And so they might have 6 to 30 different options on what best fits what you're trying to purchase and the best loan package for that. Because if a bank's trying to buy a certain segment of buyer, if they're trying to acquire that certain segment of buyer, they'll typically give the best deal on that type of a loan package. Usually, very often, what we used to do, because now we don't do a whole lot of conventional because we're kind of past that 10 threshold. So what we used to do, not really sure if this is something that still occurs, but the first thing we were doing was looking at my 4-3-2-1 strategy of quadplex, triplex, duplex, single family. The reason that we would start off with that was because they would never let you go the other way. Single family, dupe, tri, quad. They don't let you go larger. So a lot of times we'll start with that quad. And the reason that we'll start with a quad is A, because they'll give us a loan on that. But in fighting with them or working with them, as better said, you will find that it will feel like fighting every once in a while. But in working with the bank on trying to get your absolute best pricing, one of the things that we talk about is bringing to them the information. Here's what the rents are currently. Here's what the rents are going to be based on here's all these other factors. So we talk about a lot of the income side, because the healthier that they think the deal is, usually the better rate that they're able to say, oh, we can put you in this program, we can put you in this, or, oh, I see, now you hit a higher threshold for how much money is actually being brought to the deal. Now you have a higher threshold. And so we can actually do this at an eighth less or a quarter less. There's a lot of different scenarios for that. So I look, you know, one of the things that we looked at was in the multifamilies that we would purchase. And when we say multifamily, we mean 1 to 4 unit stuff, not any of the big stuff. But the 1 to 4 unit stuff is we would actually talk through that with them and say, here's what the rents are currently, much like Dion's fantastic binder method. We would say, and here's what the rents are for applicable units also around there, almost kind of on the front end, doing the appraiser's work for them. That way it wasn't just them hearing it from the appraiser and getting the appraiser's report, but them also hearing it from us. Hey, I'm a pretty savvy guy. I'm a pretty savvy businessman in this arena. I know what the rents are. I know what the building's worth, et cetera, et cetera. And a lot of times that's pretty valuable. I know for me that made a pretty big difference being able to talk through that conversation with the mortgage broker.
What's really cool about asking you this question is pointing out the next level mindset of an investor. Because when we're first starting out, when we're thinking of getting a loan to buy an investment property, the last thing most of us think of is pointing out to the lender how much money that property is going to make.
Yes.
It makes sense once you hear it. But before you hear that, we think, what is my credit score? How much money do I have in reserves? How long have I had my job? Can I show 2 years of income in the same field to qualify for a loan? Like, the steps to get a lender in the beginning are very different than once you have a portfolio and you have a history that you can show as an investor to the lenders. Here's why I'm a safe bet to lend money to. And the safer bet you are, the better rates you get.
Yes.
Initially, to get the best rates, I focused on credit score. So the question I'm going to have for you is, when you are shopping your rates like that, because I know somebody watching is probably thinking the same thing, how is your credit score involved in loans once you're past the 10 in your name?
Yep. So once you're past the 10, it doesn't matter a whole lot. It really becomes about the property. It comes about the property, it comes about the rents, it becomes about your reserves. That's always a thing. It comes to your rental income. That's always a thing. It comes to your W-2 income. That still remains a thing. They will tell you it's easier to lend to you if you have a W-2 job on top of your rental properties. That's what they will, that will happen unequivocally.
When they're looking at your reserves, my experience so far is only 10 mortgages or less in my name because I don't haven't hit that limit yet. There was a time in 2020 when I was buying a fourplex and it literally took me down to $200 in my account, which I felt safe to do because I had the income snowball kicked in where I had money coming in from other rentals and I was going to get the rent from the fourplex and there wasn't going to be a payment for a month. So within a month, I had another $10,000 in the account.
Sure.
But for the bank to recognize reserves, I used a retirement account. Lenders will recognize 50% of a retirement account as reserves. You don't have to tap it. You don't have to take it out. You just have to prove that you have the funds. It's seasoned. It has to be in there for more than 2 months. Does that still work when you have commercial loans?
It does. So every single year when you're on the commercial side, they make you fill out this three lovely letters, PFS, personal financial statement. It's literally like a financial frisking, a deep frisking.
Well, the thing that I like about it the most, and I get this from Robert Kiyosaki, and I think you can appreciate this, as I made it through high school with a 1.1 GPA. What will it take to get into the Marine Corps? Because I don't want to know or need to know any of this stuff they're trying to make me learn. Yeah. And you made it to the ninth grade?
I did. That's it. Ninth grade. So yeah. Take everything I say with a grain of salt because I'm only a ninth grader.
But what I'm saying is that's a good thing.
Yeah.
When you're going out to buy a property, no lender has ever said, what was your GPA? What things did you volunteer to do in high school? Were you on the student council? They say, show me your financial statement.
That's right.
And yes, it is a deep frisking. They come in and they ask, where did this $500 go in March?
Yes.
And yes, to explain what a weekend with two friends from the Marine Corps visiting from 20 years ago means, $500 in alcohol.
Sure.
Once we have the basics down of this is my credit score, this is my proof of 2 years, here's my reserves. Mm-hmm. When I shop around, since it's still on my personal name, they do check your credit once. So you're going to get a minor ding to your credit, but then you get a 30-day window where you can talk to other lenders. And if they do a hard check on your credit, it doesn't have another negative impact.
Yes.
So you want to shop around. And this is something I learned from my parents when I was a kid. It was really weird. Super poor. We lived in Los Angeles. We used to move into houses. We would fix the doors and windows and live there until the owners found out. And then my parents said we weren't squatters because we wouldn't stay and force the owner to go through an eviction. As soon as they found out we were living there, we would just move to the next place and start the process all over. But my parents, they weren't hoarders because the house wasn't full of stuff. But every weekend we would go to swap meets.
Okay.
And flea markets in some areas.
Is what my kind of people.
Right. And so they would... the saying in our family was, I've never seen that before in my life, but I know I can't live without it. Like, whatever it was, my dad, when I was a kid, taught me negotiating skills at a table at a swap meet. And he said, the person with the walk away power has the
always
power.
Wins. That's right.
Works That's with right. lenders. You earlier you said, you know, you don't call a lender and say, give me your best deal or hang up on me because they'll choose to hang up on you.
Right. Because
especially right now, everyone's trying to buy places. Demand is, you know, three times supply. People are doing refinances because rates are really low. So lenders have all the business that they want. Mm-hmm. But when I talk to a lender and I ask them what their rates are going to be, and I get it in writing, just an offer of this is what my rates would be. This is what my fees would be. I take that in writing to another lender and I let them see what the competition is offering. Mm-hmm. Be surprised. The competitive nature of it exists in agents and lenders and almost every business, they will do almost anything to beat a competitor because not only does it mean that they're going to make money, but it means their competition
they take it away from them.
Is not going to make that money.
That's right.
And I go to at least three and I do vary, like you said, one's a broker, one's a large bank, I was doing credit unions for a while, but I haven't had any good luck with those around here recently. So I go to Guild Mortgage and Fairway Mortgage.
Sure.
And it does take a little bit of back and forth. You know, sometimes I get their offer back and go back and go to the original lender to give them a chance to beat it. And some people think, well, that's too much work. I'm just going to get a broker, get to know them and just have this one person. And I think, are you going to have one contractor and never get another quote? And if you're willing to get three quotes for a $5,000 deck, why aren't we willing to take the time to get three quotes for a 30-year commitment for hundreds of thousands of dollars?
Just between friends.
Just between friends, right.
Yeah. So I think that's dead. I mean, that's a strategy dead on. And I think you're doing it exactly right. I think you're telling people to do it right. I mean, that's, like I said, that's why I talked to about it, is why are you not shopping that? You shop everything else. I guarantee that a lot of times before you'll maybe buy something on Amazon, because Prime doesn't take a day anymore. Now it takes a week. So I guarantee that you'll actually look up in a, you know, in a local store and say, oh, yeah, you have that. Because if you need it within the next couple of days, you'll probably just go buy it and you'll pay the premium. And so there's that service there that you just need to understand what exactly is it that you're paying for. Because here's the funny thing. Almost zero of those banks are going to actually hold and own your loan.
I was just going to say the exact same thing.
Yeah. They're going to only service your loan. So if they're only servicing it, which means they're picking up the phone and calling you, or they're their customer service when you have a question about your mortgage statement or your escrow account, they're only servicing your loan. They don't actually own it. And so when it comes down to it, all they're doing is they're living off what's called the spread. They borrow it for 1% or a 0.5%, and they're giving it to you at 3%. They're making that spread. That's it.
That's what confused me for a while. In order for most lenders to recognize rental income, they want to see it on your tax returns for 2 years.
Yes.
And if they're looking at recognizing the rental income on the property you're purchasing, they will recognize 75% of the rental income as long as you have 3 months remaining on your leases. And it confused me that a lender was letting me make a 30-year commitment based on having a 3-month commitment from a tenant.
Yeah, sure.
But that lender knew that within 3 months, they weren't going to own the loan anymore.
That's right.
So it makes sense to me now.
Yeah. And FHA has now gone up to 85% of that rent. So conventional is 75%. They'll take into account 75% of the rents. FHA will actually take into account 85%.
Awesome.
Of the loan.
That's actually something I didn't know.
So it's extra money. But again, all of us only have one FHA loan. And if you have more than 10 buildings, you don't get an FHA loan. And you only get to use one FHA loan, I think. And you certainly have a VA loan, but you only get to use one of those loans at a time. But they're the biggest pain in the tail documentation wise, but they're the best asset that you have as a purchaser, because it's 3.5% down. They will take into account 85% of the rents. And that a lot of times can be a difference maker. And then if you're looking at a property that needs a little bit of work, then everyone says, oh, FHA, stay away, because it needs work. And if it needs a heating system or a roof or a kitchen, FHA won't approve you. And so a lot of listings now will say, you know, can't qualify for FHA. Here's where they're wrong. It can qualify for FHA, just not FHA standard. It can qualify for something called an FHA 203 or an FHA 203K Streamline. And those two products are basically rehab products. I'm helping a student with one right now. And he's actually going to be able to upgrade. It's a 4-unit. He's going to upgrade all the kitchens, all the heating systems, redo all the floors, and update the electrical for that $35,000. He's basically going to have a brand new house.
So I've helped a few people with a FHA 203K loan as well.
Yep.
And the struggle is finding a contractor that understands the system for getting paid, that it's
yes.
paid in increments of when you finish this aspect yes. of the project, you get paid this month. Then you go on to the next one. But if you find that contractor, it's a great format. And if you are interested in knowing the difference between a conventional loan and an FHA loan, here's a video of me arguing with myself. and I'm going to have to make a new one now in the future and add the 85% for FHA, because that's something I didn't know at the time.
Yeah, huge opportunity for folks. There's a lot of opportunity out there, and it just comes down to the same thing, which is you got to do the work. You got to do the research. You've got Dion Talk here, who gives you just an absolute ton of information that is valuable to helping you find a lender and to helping you find, you know, researching your properties and understanding what your market and understanding what a good deal is. It just comes down to doing the work.
Someday in the future, I'm probably going to have 10 conventional loans, and I'm going to need to get that first commercial.
But not today.
Because that's the point that you'll get to. So you'll do your first 10 deals, which are, you know, going to be Fannie Freddie deals. They're going to be deals with a bank that's going to sell that mortgage and become, and somebody's going to be a servicer. Then you get your next set of deals and you start doing commercial stuff. And then after you've accumulated enough properties / wealth / once you get to that point, then they start calling you with, so we have a special portfolio program. And I'm like, special. I think I'm special. I love special.
They knew what
things.
To say.
Yeah.
I had my banker called me 6 or 7 years ago
Yep.
First couple of times I had over six figures in my account, and you know, they could see rental income coming in, and they called me and they just said, "Hey, you know, I'm your branch manager, and I see that you're one of our most valued customers. Is there anything I could do for you?" And I said, "You could call me 10 years ago when I had $50 in my account and I really needed some help." Yes. So I still keep my money in that bank, but none of my loans are with that bank.
Yeah. And see, the funny thing is that, and you can explore this too, but talk to some of those other banks that you have loans with or that might have some loans with. Talk to them and say, what would it mean to you? What could I get for a rate on my next deal if I brought my cash deposits to your bank? That means something to them. That's, yeah,
and everything's negotiable.
Yeah. Well, the bigger thing is that, so the Fed and the government, what their requirements are is you get to loan a percentage of your deposits. And so if you increase their deposit base, they get to lend out more money, and it's all a multiplier.
With fractional lending, it gets lent out nine times. Every dollar that you put in there is lent out nine times.
That's right. That gives you just, I mean, think about the driver's seat that puts you in. You know, if you can all of a sudden come to this bank and say, sure, here's what I can do. I can actually give you $20,000 a month of rental income coming into your bank on a monthly basis. I guarantee they find a way to shave a quarter of a point off your next deal or give you more favorable terms or figure out some other program that they can put you in. That stuff exists. And you just have to learn to ask the questions. You might be in a position, a lot of people are in the position right now where they haven't even done their first. And so they don't have any idea that any of those things exist. But just ask the questions. They're there to answer those questions. Also understand just what you're building towards. All right, this is my first one. This is what we had to do on this one. But what do I need to look out for on the second one? Ask them, because every bank is a little bit different.
A lot of people who work in the banking industry understand compound interest. So when they think of things, they're looking at timelines in years, maybe a decade, where most people are thinking this year.
Right.
And that banker's thinking of building the relationship that lasts. They actually have... not too many people know this until you start investing, but banks have relationship manager position. Yes. Mm-hmm. And so it's their job to make sure they keep your business. I want to say thanks for taking the time and sharing your knowledge today. I've actually learned several things from you myself. I'm going to make sure everybody knows to check you out at Lumberjack Landlord on YouTube. And you also have lumberjacklandlord.com. I think you're a lot like me, where you like to answer questions and help people out. And you probably have the same opinion, where the world just seems like it's a better place if we get more people to financial freedom, so they're doing jobs they want to do instead of jobs they have to do.
Absolutely. Dion, thank you so much for the time. Really appreciate the opportunity and look forward to doing this again. Thanks, everybody.
Until my next video, thanks for coming to my Dion Talk.
We're sorry. The number you have dialed is not in service at this time.
I always tell them, I say, I don't really feel like you're working very hard on our relationship.
I've said that to a few people too, and that might be why I'm single.
They aren't doing as much for you as a mortgage broker will.